In the Dallas meeting where we met with many preachers, and there ought to have been many more there, for the life of me, I cannot see why preachers cannot open their eyes to see that when our church home is closed, their churches will close later. When they can pick out my superintendent, set all the rules and regulations, 33 of them, and then say, you'll either go under them or we'll close you down. They can also close the churches when you get ready. Now, why you can't see that, I don't know. You think, well, it'll never happen. You said it never happened like this, did you? You said they'll never close Brother Roloff's homes, but 400 lonely young people headed back down a bad street. And so, I believe when they get to our home, they'll have our church, they'll have my ministry, but they'll never get it. I've been living. You know the reason we got these here? We're underground. We've never let them see our records. How many of you under 16? Hold up your hands. They call that contempt. God calls it mercy. And if you folks haven't got enough intestinal fortitude to fight for little old helpless girls that's been ravaged by the vultures of this generation, I don't have one lick of respect for you, not a bit. I wouldn't let you pigtail on my ball team. I really wouldn't. I have no confidence in you. I don't believe you deserve to live in the land of the free, in the home of the brave. I really don't. And that's what the fight's all about. I know what some of you say. Why don't you come under? Well, why don't you just go ahead? That's what I tell them. Why don't you just quit preaching? That's what I'd have to do. You've seen me many times for the last 25 years in this city. You'll never see me again with a Bible in my hand any time I turn my back on God's rules and regulations, which is the King James Version. Amen. I've made a lot of mistakes and blunders and all that, but brothers, one thing, I've never lowered my preaching to suit my practicing, but I've tried to pull my practicing up where my preaching was. Well, you said the hardest thing I ever do is to practice what you preach. Me too. But it's worthwhile. Amen. And out of all this fight, I've got one thing left, and that's it. I've got my conscience. I still can sleep at night. The last month has been a very difficult time, but I'm glad that I still believe that I'm right. That's the reason I can stay in the fight. I wrote this for the preachers, though. Now the preachers wouldn't bow. The state got mad and said, you can turn it furnace up high, tie them up, and throw them in, the prophets. And the churches are going to fry. A little while later, they looked in the furnace. They heard God's people say, you can pull up a chair, and I'd like you to meet my Savior. He's just the same today.
Hey, run if you will. But I came here today when I fall down, try to get right up because of this star I have to play.
It's a battlefield, but I'm not a recreation room.
It's a fight and not a game. Run if you want to, run if you will.
Than the honey and the honeycomb.
Sweet singing, isn't it? That's the right kind of singing. Yes, sir, that's the kind of singing we need, especially from people who've been redeemed. Now, when they came, practically every girl was hooked, I mean hooked, on the worst dope that you've ever known in your life, and that's rock and roll. There's nothing more poison than rock and roll. I mean, I'd rather have a rattlesnake bite any time than that just to fill my soul and my mind. That's the most thing, and listen, the most danger it ever brings is when it crawls up in the church. That's where it eats up the life of your people. There's nothing decent about the beat of rock music. Nothing. It's immoral. It's kin to dope. And it has nothing good to offer you. And you can get mad all you want to, but all these come in. And wherever you find rock and roll, you'll find dope and you'll find immorality.
Right.
You go to these rock festivals, they're the nastiest things on the face of this earth. Now, you can grin and bump your gums and chew your tongue, whatever you want to do, buddy, but I'm telling you the truth tonight. And whenever you buck things like this, because you haven't got much spiritual sense. Because look what we do. We've been working with them now for so many years, we ought to know. They tell us. They tell us that. They sent me a powerful record from the West Coast. And they presented it all over the nation. And the radio station, is about 2 hours. I mean, about 2 hours. And the radio station just began to gobble it up. I said, uh-oh. Man, I tell you. But the man, he said, Brother Roloff, I want you to help me publicize this and so forth. And he said, I just want you to, I'm going to send you a copy. I said, okay. Man, listen, they had the fanciest musicians and all the orchestra and everything. Now, you talk about Sister Sputendijk rock and roll, that's it. I mean, they had it. I mean, they really, listen, they spent some sum of money on getting out that deal. And so I got it, and I played just about that much of it. I said, man alive, a wolf in sheep's clothing. But in order to be for sure, I brought one of my dope addicts in from the lighthouse, old Sammy Sullivan, and another one. He's in Bob Jones University. Mike DeLindy's there. And old Steve, out the city, he's there. And he's the worst dope head we ever did. And we just had, and they got, Greg's there, and his daddy's there. Bernadette and others are down in Bob Jones. Got them all over this country in the schools. And so I called him in and said, say, I got a record I want to play for you. Would you go in the studio? And he said, yes, sir. He went in, we closed the door, and I put the record on, and he'd look up at me. I said, what's the matter? He said, that's the very rhythm and that's the very beat that I took my dope with. He said, that's rock music. I said, yeah, listen to the words. He said, don't make no difference, but the words said, that's rock. See? I can understand why they call it acid, but I can't understand why they call it rock. But I know the acid, to me, it's just about like taking LSD. That's acid, isn't it? I warn you, mothers and dads, anytime you permit that filth to sit in your home, you're sending your children to hell. And you send them just as straight to the prison or to Brother Roloff as you can possibly do it. And I'll guarantee we're not going to put up with it in any of our homes and with our children. And I just want to warn you about it. Say, we've been traveling a lot. Let's take some exercise. Will you do that? Do y'all like taking a little exercise tonight? Yeah, that's right. The Bible said exercise yourself unto God. You know, it's powerfully silent in here tonight. Did y'all take some sleeping pills before you came? Really, that's a puzzle to me. Those little girls couldn't even jump that high when they came. No, sir. Those girls were hooked on sin. And you know, it'd have been a good place for y'all to just say praise the Lord or amen or something, you see. Really is. I tell you, I'm not used to this formalistic stuff. I'm really not. And so these are your children. You ought to be glad to see your children. Did you know that? You're the stockholders of the enterprises. And I brought you a load of dividends tonight. And y'all just sit out there and say, amen. But these have been brought back from the dead. Did you know that? They were vicious monsters when they came in. I can put little girls out here to testify. They tore down doors and windows and they ran and they did everything else. But now then, they've had the opportunity to run on this door, but they didn't run. The Lord, man asked me, two probation officers asked me the other day, said, what's your percentage? I know, what's your batting average? I said, between 90 and 95%. He said, that's 98% better than we're doing. He said, we bat 1 or 2%. I just got the picture from the probation officer in long testimony. He said, those homes are only homes. I've replaced children where they get help. Isn't that sad? Dallas said that. Corpus Christi, the man out at the juvenile shelter, little girl, 14, the lady said, he said to her mother when she came, said, I'm not supposed to tell you this, especially with the battle going, but do your best to get in Rebecca. She's out there now. And so we just, we'll not be able to understand just why the fight is so vicious, but we know that the devil doesn't like to see little girls. He can take a little girl and make a bunch of people fall. Did you know that? He can take a little girl and break up a home. I tell you, I think the favorite play toy of the devil is a little girl. Now, used to he couldn't get by with it. Somebody would keep close friend get him. Mm-hmm. Brother. I guarantee you, brother, when I was a little boy, if some old verse had picked up a little 13 or 12 or 14-year-old girl and took her out and kept her for 3 or 4 or 5 days, boy, just as soon as he got back, there'd been a necktie party. I mean, he'd just been swinging by limb the next morning. Ku Klux Klan put on their robe. You say you don't believe in that? No, but if I ever started believing in it, I'd start with an old verse to do that. Oh, my soul. Trouble we're in today. Say, it's nice to have Miss Alice, Brother Mrs. Cameron. Brother Cameron, could you set the little boy down and bring him up here? I want you to have a word of testimony tonight. This is a Georgia boy, I guess. He's been down to Macon, building churches, went out to the city, worked with Brother Johnny, came over, worked with Brother Raymond Weatherford, And now then, he's the kind of the head man around the home and the Rebecca home and the farm. And so it's good to have you, Brother Cameron. And then let's have Alice, the daughter. She came in. She's in school here in Georgia. And let her come and sing a song.
And it's great to be in Georgia. I'll tell you, Texas is fine if the Lord puts you there. But that 40-mile-an-hour wind and all the dust and the rest of it. But praise the Lord for the little girls that he grows down there at Rebecca. And we praise the Lord for your prayers and your support. It's yeah. great to be in the midst of the battle, brother. And I believe it's the end time battle.
Yeah.
But I'm glad we're going to win the war.
Yes.
And you pray for the needs at the Rebecca home. Pray for all the girls. Many we could not bring with us tonight. And they have needs tonight just like these. And so I know that you want to pray for them and ask God to bless them and save them. And we've had some saved on the tour, and we praise the Lord for that. Yeah. God's still in the miracle working business, brother. And you get close to him, and you can get to see some of those miracles. And I praise the Lord for the opportunity to be associated with the miracle ministries of the enterprises. You pray for Brother Roloff, the burden. As he said a moment ago, when we get back to Corpus, we'll be going down to the courthouse again and wasting all that time, really, just to answer some silly questions. It'll not amount to anything when we meet Jesus anyhow.
Amen.
But you pray for faithfulness till that time comes. Thank you.
Amen. Me and Alice, they came from St. Thomas down in the mission field. Her sister came to us first. She's in Tennessee Temple School now. And the other little girl, Janet, she came from St. Thomas also, singing.
Started 10,000.
Let me have Brother Russell sing.
You must. I want you to come sing. This man has written 200 songs. And I want you to climb up Calvary tonight. Will you do that? That's such a precious song. He sings the songs he writes. And I've said this before, and he won't mind me. If you talk with him, he may be a little slow on the draw. I mean, he has a impediment and so forth. But the amazing thing, God has given him talent to write songs and sing them and never stutter.
Amen.
Now, to me, that's a miracle. And his wife is going to sing with him, and they're going to sing, I think, Russ, one of the sweetest songs you've ever written. And he has many of them. You're going to get a blessing as you listen to them sing.
As Jesus
walked up Calvary's hill to suffer and die in pain and agony,
they placed the crown
of thorns upon his head and a cross on his back. But he knew for
eternity
must die.
He cried, "Not my will,
Father, but thine. Let this cup pass from me.
Forgive them,
they know not what they do. And the sun refused to shine.
He bowed his head in night,
but he rose again,
and he lives within my heart. Oh, how I praise
him, because he died for me.
When he reached the top of Calvary's hill,
he laid down his cross, and they placed it in between two thieves.
They drove big nails
into his precious hand. They drove nails into his feet.
But he knew
for sinners he must die.
He cried, "Not my will,
Father, but thine. Let this cup pass from me.
Forgive
them, they know not what they do. And the sun refused to shine.
He bowed his head
and died, but he rose again. And he lives
within my heart. Oh, how I praise
him, because he died for me."
Amen. Have your Bible, turn with me, please, and to the discouraging book. You'd say, "Brother Roloff, we don't want to be discouraged." No, I know. And we're not going to be, but maybe I should call it the crossword puzzle book. And let's see if we can figure it out. You know what that is, don't you? Ecclesiastes. What does this book teach? I tell you, you do a lot of wandering through the wilderness in this book. The wise man prayed as a boy. The Lord said, "Son, what would you like?" He said, "I'd like wisdom. I'd like wisdom." Now, listen to me. You may get wisdom and then not apply wisdom. That's your trouble. The big mistake most Christians make is not doing as well as they know. You remember the farmer that the old man, the high-powered same went to see, and he was so busy, grass was growing so fast, and so all of a sudden, he just went up to him and said, "Sir, you've just got to get this set of books." I mean, it'll tell you how to farm. It'll just tell you everything. And the farmer was so impatient with him because he had so much work to be done. The fellow was just piecing out the books and showing them. The farmer said what most of us would have to say, "Sir, I'm not doing half as well as I know now." It's not more knowledge, it's the right kind of knowledge and applied knowledge. Now, the Bible said, if we seek or ask for wisdom, we're going to get it. We're going to get it. The Bible said it's a gift. God will give you wisdom. Any of you lack wisdom? Everybody's born without a lick of wisdom. Now, you might say your baby's cute or he's a doll or isn't he precious. You never hear anybody say, "I've got the wisest baby you've ever seen." Dumbest thing that ever got into the world is a human baby. Can't even hold their head up. Can't even focus their eyes. It's all, why? I mean, you talk about helpless. Brother, did you know that everything good that's going to happen to you, that'll be permanent and lasting, will have to happen after you get born again? I've come again. You will never have any wisdom before you get saved. I can prove it. Suppose you see me walking down the street. "Hello, Brother Roloff." "Yes, sir. Good morning." "Where are you going?" I said, "They've got a big bonfire down here, and I'm going to jump in it." "You don't mean it?" "Yeah. I figured that'd be the quickest way out of this thing. And I'm going down and jumping the fire, and I'll cremate myself." "You think I'd have wisdom?" "Man, they'd have policemen and everything else if they thought I was going to do it." "All right, come on." A lost man comes down the street. I said, "Where are you going?" "Hell, when are you going to go?" "As soon as I can." "I'm on the way." Sinner friend, don't you realize how crazy and stupid and ignorant and lost and awful it is, knowing that you may get your last call tonight? You don't preach 43 years without preaching somebody and many people's last message they've ever heard. I've seen them sitting out there right in front of me, and they listened, and before daylight, they were dead in the floor of their own home. Let me give you another illustration. This happened. I was out visiting, we was in a tent campaign, and the lady committed herself and said to her neighbor after we talked, said, "I'm going to church next Sunday morning, and when that sermon is over and the invitation is given, I plan to give my life to Christ and become a Christian next Sunday morning. And it'll probably be around 12 o'clock, but I'll guarantee you that I'm going to give my heart to Christ next Sunday morning." She kept her promise. She came. She walked in. She sat on the third row right there. She sat right there. She heard me read Isaiah chapter 53. "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?" And I went on through the chapter, but when I got about half through the chapter, this lady, because the seat was not completely filled, she laid over in the seat. I mean, she didn't get up either. There was a medical doctor on the front row, and somebody nudged him and told him to see about the lady. He called for four men before I got through reading my text, and they got a hold of this lady and carried her out at the door. The doctor said, "Brother Roloff, she was dead when she went through the door. She was 45 minutes away from her accepted time." I mean, as far as she's concerned. She said, "I'm going to accept Jesus Christ at the close of the service." She came, she kept her promise, she sat there, but she didn't have till 12 o'clock today. At 11:15, so far as we know, she fell into hell. You say, "I don't believe in hell." You wait around.
Amen.
I don't know if any infidel ever believed in hell, but there's a lot of them there to testify tonight. There's one. I read in my Bible about one man who went there, and I want you to know he started calling for Father Abraham. Abraham wasn't his father. He's just the father of the faithful. He wasn't faithful. He died without faith in Jesus Christ. And then he said, oh, I want somebody to send a drop of water. And I've often wondered, and put it on my tongue. Right and white on his tongue. I know you get thirsty. Don't you imagine his old tongue had been a sharp tongue? He's unsaved. Can't wicked people be sharp with their tongues? And God's people are too sharp with theirs. You think of the needless tears that have been shed today because of some old wretched tongue. His tongue is tormenting him. I imagine he's chewing on his tongue. I imagine his old tongue is swollen up. And he cried for help, didn't he? Then you know what else he did? He did not ask Abraham to come get him. Did you notice that? You said he'd want out? Yeah, but he knew he'd never get out. He'd never get out. Hell is as permanent as heaven. And I know the modernists don't believe in hell anymore. I know that the professors in these religious schools, they never mention hell anymore. And one man said, I wouldn't be afraid. I wouldn't be afraid. Shows how stupid and how sacrilegious. Now, a wicked man spoke up one day and said, I wouldn't be afraid to go to hell now. I said, why? He said, there's so many rich men there until they've already got an air conditioner. No, brother. There'll be no cool breeze blowing through hell.
Amen.
Since Jesus saved me, I've never told another man to go to hell except the devil. I'll tell him to go to hell. I usually am nice. I just tell him to go home. But oh, there's not a man wicked enough. My most wicked enemy. I could never want him to go to hell.
Amen.
Not a one of them.
Amen.
Oh, I'd say, Lord, save them.
Amen.
The people that have closed our homes and have fought us, the newspapers that have called us everything but a Christian. I've never prayed for one of them to go to hell. But
amen.
I tell you what, I'm, and if you'd have heard Dr. Bob Jones pray, I tell you that's the closest to judgment prayer I've ever heard in my life. But, dear friends, I will ask God to bring His kind of judgment on them. I believe they need to be judged. And I think God needs, and God has the right to judge them before judgment. I mean before the judgment time. I believe He's got a right to judge the enemy today. I believe Jesus loves these girls and loves boys and wants them to have an opportunity. Ecclesiastes 12, chapter 1. Are we going through anything new? Are we going? Verse 11 said, all the rivers run into the sea, yet the sea is not full. Unto the place from whence the rivers come, thither they return again. Have you ever thought about how God changes the water? He pick it up and carry it up in the cloud, and then send the cloud over there and drop it again. And then it'll run back into the sea, and the sea won't run over. God got all that stuff. God's got a restraining order. You read it in the Bible. He's got a restraining order on the sea. He says, you can just come so far, and that's it, and I don't come any further. Stay, right? You know, I mean, he can just pull his omnipotent pistol and say, stand where you are. Don't you come any further. People got scared. You remember Noah got scared? One time it seemed that he got scared, and he said, I imagine he heard a big clap of thunder, and his wife said, oh, me. And I imagine the lightning began to flash, and Noah said, I believe I'll run to my prayer place and say, Lord, is it coming another one? Maybe the water was running every which way. He said, no. He said, when I get through with the rain, I'll let the sun come out, I'm going to paint you a rainbow. And so God took his big brush, you know, and just painted. Oh, he can do it so quick, you know. And I've been flying along. I've had some great experiences coming out of storms and looking at the rainbow. And I never forget going to City of Refuge, trying to get there for the camp meeting years ago. And I was coming along that old single engine, and I was right over the treetops, just right over the treetops. And I had, I don't know who I was with me, but a load in the plane. And we were coming along, and we just ran out of visibility. And we ran out of, it just was horrible weather. And I didn't know where, I wanted to be there that night for the service. And so, directly I came out of a cloud, and so help me, there was a rainbow right in front of me. And the best I could see, I literally went through the rainbow. Just went through it. And I said, I'm going on. That's my hope. That's the rainbow of hope. And I went on and landed there just a little bit later. But he said here, all things are full of labor. Man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. That's true, isn't it? I preached the other night, and I think I shook my people up a little bit. I said, I've never been satisfied. When I got saved, I wasn't satisfied. When God called me to preach, I wasn't satisfied. I've never been satisfied down here, never will.
I've never had complete satisfaction down here. The psalmist said the same thing when he said, I shall be satisfied with his likeness. I'm not enough like Jesus to be satisfied. Now, I'm satisfied with him. I'm satisfied with the Holy Spirit. I'm satisfied with the Word of God. I'm satisfied with the King James Version. I'm satisfied with God's call and God's salvation, but I'm not satisfied with the attainments and accomplishments in my personal Christian life. I'm not satisfied tonight. I'm a restless Christian. Oh, I'm resting in him, but I'm still hungry for more. And I want to be more like him. Now, verse 9, the thing that hath been, it is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun. Did you get that? Did you know we face nothing new? People say, what about space? Well, what about Moses and Elijah come circling in, and they wasn't in the capsule? They sure been up a long time, hadn't they? Peter, James, and John looked up and said, look, coming yonder. No wings either. Wasn't angels, brothers, Moses and Elijah. The lawyer and the prophet. I came the law and the prophets right there. I guess they... And the law was going to represent the prophet. Moses was God's lawyer. Elijah was God's prophet. Paul was God's theologian. David was God's singer. And 3 out of 4 of them were ex-convicts. That's a miracle. I guarantee it's a miracle. Listen, Moses was sentenced to 40 years in the wilderness because he killed an Egyptian. And he graduated and took his postgraduate course at the burning bush. And another wilderness became his laboratory. And he led 3,500,000 people out of Egyptian bondage. Can you imagine? No wonder we were singing the great I am. That's who helped him. Not the great I was. I won't get it. Well, I'm in so much trouble, I couldn't wait on the I was or I shall be. I got to have an I am. I mean, I get in that courthouse and I get to hearing them old jail doors slam and so forth. I don't need a has-been God. I got to have somebody come up in the courthouse now. And that'll be no strange thing, for he's been there before. And he'll go with us again. Well, he said there's no new thing under the sun. You talk about this old trip hammer, you know. You hear it knocking up the street. What about the pecker wood? Ever heard of a woodpecker? I mean, just really pecking away? Trip hammer. What about the helicopter? That thing just flies every which way, you know. Up and down. What about the hummingbird? Same thing, just on a smaller style, but you never hear one fall and kill himself. Boy, didn't you think you had something when you got a garbage disposal, didn't you? Huh? Wasn't that something? Just to put it in that tongue, then there she goes. You said, that's new. No, it's not. How do you think Noah kept the ark clean for over a year? With all them animals in there. You said, you think he had to keep it clean? Somebody did, because that's a type of Jesus. Come on. I guarantee Jesus stayed clean. And I'm in him. And the only clean I've got is what he cleaned. I mean, I'm in the maximum security unit tonight. Well, you say, how do you think it? God had a plan, because they wasn't in the door to open. They sure couldn't sweep the trash out. And they couldn't haul it out, could they? No, sir. And I don't believe they threw it up through the window. Come on. Because that's going to be our rapture window. We're going out at the top. Moses told us all about that in the 5 books of law. Now then, let's hasten on to another chapter. Chapter 2, verse 13. Then I saw that wisdom excelleth folly as far as light excelleth darkness. Chapter 2, verse 26. I'm just taking some verses I marked a while ago. For God giveth to a man, notice what he gives to him. that is good in his sight. Notice, a man not good in the world's sight, good in God's sight. God said, I've got some gifts for you because you're good in my sight. Wisdom, I'm going to give you wisdom. Wisdom belongs to good men. Bad men never have wisdom. Only good men have access to wisdom. Bible said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, he's become our wisdom. That's Jesus. He's my wisdom. A bad man doesn't know Jesus. He has no wisdom. He has no wisdom for time or eternity. Now, he gives me wisdom, knowledge, and notice what else? Joy. Joy. Oh, listen. Let's go to the third chapter now, and we find another. You know, he said to everything, there's a season, time to be ever purpose under the heaven. Born, die, plant, pluck up, kill, time to steal and heal, and time to break down, a time to build up. Let me get that straight now. There's a time to kill and a time to heal, and a time to break down, time to build up, time to weep, time to laugh, time to mourn, time to dance, time to cast away stone, time to gather stone together. He goes on. Time to get, time to lose, time to keep, time to cast away, time to rend, time to sow, time to keep silence, time to speak, time to love, time to hate, time of war, time of peace. And then he goes on, verse 11. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Also it set the world in their hearts, so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from the beginning to the end. Now, verse 12, I know that there's no good in them, but for a man to rejoice and to do good in his life, to do good, but you got to be good before you can do good. Now then, verse 14 and 15, brothers, a stronghold for us today. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. He said, I know. Didn't say, I guess, or think, or suppose, or hope. He said, I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing. Do you get that? I would ask you, who saved you? Well, you said, the Lord saved me. Then it's forever salvation you got. Well, I said, well, now, I was saved, but I'm not saved anymore. But then God didn't do it then. And that's the truth, really. I mean, they just know. A lady wrote me last week. She said, Brother Roloff, you preach sinless perfection and also falling from grace. Are not falling from grace. Said, you preach each one of you to be and sinless perfection. Well, if I never did sin, I couldn't be lost. But here's the thing amazing about the grace of God. I never dreamed, really, when I got saved. I thought, well, man, I'll never sin no more now. But first thing you know, I did. When I got called to preach, I thought, well, this ought to cure me forever. I'm going to be a preacher. God told me I could preach the gospel of Jesus. Sad to say, I sinned again. But I've never been lost. Here's the difference. I've never been happy in sin since I got saved. It's never satisfied. Now notice, he said, I know that whatsoever the Lord doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it. Nothing can be taken from it. The Lord doeth it, that men may fear. Now, that's going to be my word during my message tonight. We've lost the fear of God. And the church and the preachers and the prophets have got to preach fear back into the people. I mean, for God. That's respect I'm talking about. Why, people today, they have no more. Listen, down yonder in our senator deal, that man got up and cussed me, asked God to damn me as a demigod, and said I was crazy. Right on the floor before all the senators, you see. And all of it came out in the paper and came out on television, all that kind of stuff. Why, folks, you talk about our people in this country, they've lost the fear of God. They have no respect for God. Oh, listen, he said, whatsoever you do, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to him. Now, here we are, verse 15, chapter 3. You want to get this because this goes with the first chapter. That which has been is now. That which has been, we're going through it again. And that which is to be hath already been, and God requireth that which is past. And so we're coming back over the cycle again. That's right. We're coming right back in to unbelieving, worldly, wicked. We're repeating. You know what we're repeating now? You know what the cycle is now? Sodom's day and Gomorrah's day. We're right back in it now. Oh, listen. I think Gomorrah and Sodom both would be ashamed to see the filth we're in now. So far as I know, they never did back in those days set up a homosexual church. Did you know, really, now this is horrible to think, but I'm going to say it, that our government And our leaders, they have been more gracious to the homosexual bunch than they have to our home. They're ordaining preachers, this nation is, and they're setting up homosexual churches. They've got Satan churches all over this country. Avowed and promised to worship Satan. What a sad thing it is, dear friend, when we get to such a horrible place as this. Pay attention to me now. I got a clipping right here. When they're legalizing, they're going to legalize, it'll not be long, they're going to legalize impurity, prostitution. I got a clipping here where 200 mothers are on a strike. And they're using. Did you know that they're already in Washington putting through the best they can? And the women, these 200, you know what they said? We're every one of us good mothers. And they were striking. They said, why can't we make a living? This is the oldest profession in the world, is being a prostitute. And the mothers sat in the church, in the churches, I mean sitting in the churches, and said, we feel that we ought to be recognized, and they're on a strike. And they said, we're good mothers, and we believe that we ought to be recognized like any other business profession. In Washington, and I got the clipping in my Bible, where they said, we were trying to push through, and they were pushing through the bill, and they named it, and said for prostitution to be legalized, and they said there's one requirement that's made plain. The man who runs a house of prostitution must be of good character. What am I saying? Why, this is being fulfilled. Look here. Boy, you talk about the wickedest old hussies you've ever seen in your life. And there they are in the bingo beer drinking party, and they've applied, these churches have applied for full-time licenses for beer and strong drink. And so the beer taverns of Milwaukee have filed on this bunch of vultures, the churches. They said, why are they going to ruin our business? I said, the man right in that order, he said, I can just see people coming home from work and stopping at their church and going down. I said, yeah, that's right. They're going down, all right. Going down in the basement, see, and start drinking. And said, why, it's good. We don't mind them having big bingo games and maybe 25 times, he said, 25 times a year, and just drinking all they want. That'll not hurt us. But if they open up those things every day and night after the service or the mass or whatever they're going to have, mass mostly, if they go down there and start drinking that filthy stuff, they're going to hurt our business. Brother, that's why this country's lost confidence in the churches. Of course, I don't consider them churches just a bunch of beer taverns. Bunch of gambling dives. I don't care which way he wears his collar or what he calls himself. Another thing, I've got some clippings in my Bible. I got one clipping here of a man that went up to Colorado, and he applied for a marriage license to marry his faithful horse. Now, this is a little comical. I know you're going to laugh about it, but you know why? Two women just went up there and got him a marriage license and got married. And he went up there to protest that. He said, well, if they can marry each other, why couldn't I marry my horse? My horse a lot better than either one of them. And the paper said that the marriage license was signed for those two women by a minister. That's the reason don't ever call me a minister here. I'm so tired of saying, well, he's a minister. Brother, just call me a preacher if I can. I'm trying to make a preacher. What am I saying? We're repeating exactly what the Bible said we'd repeat. And God requires that which is past. And we're there now. And listen, good news. When we get to Sodom and Gomorrah's day, we're almost home, dear children. We're almost home. And that bunch will have this place one of these days. Can you just imagine? And of course, Brother Curtis will have nothing to do with it. Can you imagine the homosexuals operating out of this church when the rapture takes place? I'll guarantee you. But that'll be their response. Can you imagine? This is altogether possible that you'd see a big sign out in front. Satan's church. The Antichrist, the man of sin. My brother, he'll walk and talk in this building. And said, isn't it good to be rid of all those nuts? All those Christians and virgin birth bunch. Well, we'll be gone, Buster. I just want to use what God's given me till the rapture, and then they can have it.
Well, let's see what else we can find. We're just grazing. I am. I'm. Now, he mentions mouth rash. Not mouth wash. Brother, sometimes people say, I've had some of these music, real trained people say, Brother Roloff, I wish I could come and teach you little girls how to breathe. I said, honey, we're just so glad they're still breathing anyway. Yes, sir. Brother, listen, of course, I know it'd be good to learn how to breathe and support your tones and all that, but we're just sick to death that they can sing as loud as they can and want to sing. But notice, he said, verse 2 of chapter 5, be not rash with thy mouth. Don't have the mouth rash. And let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God, for God's in heaven, and thou upon earth. Therefore let thy words be few. I think what he's saying, and that word, he held his peace, or they said, hold your peace. That means keep your mouth shut. And so he said, don't forget, God's in heaven, which he's looking at you, and you down here on earth. And he said, when thou vowest a vow, verse 4, when thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it. It hath no, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou vowed. In other words, if you make a vow and don't pay it, then God calls you a fool. And then he said something else. Better is it that thou shouldst not vow than that thou shouldst vow and not pay. Now, that's what the hypocrites hide behind right there. They say, well, I'd like to make a resolution, but I know I'm going to break it. And so you cowards, you just don't do nothing, do you? Brother, I'd rather make a vow and maybe make 5 vows and keep 4 of them than to make none and keep none, see? I believe it's all right to make a... Now, here, I'm not saying make a vow and then break it. I know it's not good, but I tell you, I believe that God will help us to make and keep a Bible vow, and he'll bless us for doing it. What I'm trying to say is, don't be afraid to commit yourself and take a plunge. Where would I be today in the enterprise if I hadn't plunged? The doctors have said, well, a lot of tension, and I know that, but I've been under pressure ever since I've been a preacher. I thought when I got to preaching, especially built a lovely church and filled all the chairs and put the chairs in the aisles and baptized a lot of people and got to the top of the denominational totem pole and all the honors that they could pour upon me, I still wasn't satisfied. And the Lord led me outside the gate and I lost that whole bunch. But I tell you what, I don't believe you'll ever get up any steam without some pressure. And I just want to come into town steaming, don't you? Now, you'd say, well, what's gonna make the steam? There's 2 things that make steam, and that's fire and water. You'd say, well, why don't you explain that to me? I sure will. That's the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. That's where your steams come from. Well, listen, let's read on. See where we're going. Chapter 7. Now then, I'm going to ask a question. Do people all live out their time? Do you believe a man can die before his time? If he did, what happened to him? I mean, did God put you in the world to live so long, and did he make a promise that you could live so long? Let me read it to you. Verse 17, that's 7:17, and it'd be well for you to remember John 7:17. Those are twin scriptures. If any man do the will of God, will do the will of God, the doctrine shall be made known to him. That's John 7:17. Now, Ecclesiastes 7:17 says, be not over much wicked, neither be thou foolish. Why shouldst thou die before thy time? Why do you want to die? You young people here tonight, you know what you're going to do? You're going to disobey your mother and your daddy, and you're going to die before your time. You're going to dishonor your mother and daddy, and you're not going to live out your days down here. Do you know why we got so many teenagers dying and getting killed and going out overdose and all that? You know why? It's because they would not mind their mother and daddy. And you know why? Because mother and daddy many times didn't mind the Lord. And when you don't mind God, you'll not get your children to mind you. There's our problem in this country. Listen. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. Churches, preachers, mothers and dads, get the mothers and dads in the Lord. Build a family altar, pray, worship in the home. And so he said, you can die before your time if you are live a wicked life. Now then, go to the 8th chapter, please. There is no man that hath power over the Spirit to retain the Spirit. Neither hath he power in the day of death, and there is no discharge in that Lord. Let me ask you something. When did the greatest man in the Old Testament, a man after God's own heart, when did he really fall? When he was on furlough in the palace. Am I right? Do you remember when he sent all of his people off to war? And you know where he excelled, don't you? On the battlefield. You know when he killed Goliath? No problem at all. Just with a sling and a pocket full of rocks, and there he went. Now, he sent his men off to war, and while David, King David, was away from his great army, that's when sin set in. You know, it's hard to sin if you're in the middle of a fight and expect to get killed every minute. I mean, you just want to stay ready. Them bullets get to buzzing, you know, and you get to dodging, jump in a foxhole or behind a tree, and it's just not too easy to jump off and sin right there. But oh, when the battle's over, I said, when the battle's over and you go home and they come with all the awards and all the prizes and all the oak leaf clusters and all the people begin to holler and clap their hand, brother, that's where the danger is. And Brother Curtis Edson, I'll say to you in this church, you've grown really rapidly. You built this building, it's nearly filled tonight. And you've increased it to over 2,000 people in Sunday school. And if you'll keep your people on the run for souls, they'll live more pure and they'll be more worthwhile and happy. But you get to fighting over the bones of what you caught. And that's where your trouble's going to be. Say, I'm just tired of this and I'm tired of doing this. I'm tired. And I tell you what, you go unto yourself. And so God's people ought to be a busy, wonderful people. Verse 10 gripped me a while ago. I saw the wicked buried. I got to go to their funeral. Just let that soak a minute. You said the wicked are going to kill me. No, you can't kill you if you're going to go to their funeral. I believe God's people ought to outlive, outdine, out everything else the devil's grabbed. I remember an old man got up, and it was a question deal, and they said, how old are you? He said, 97. 97. And going strong. And they said, what do you really value the practice? What did you really do to let you live 97 and be in good health? Well, he said, I served the Lord, and I lived for Him, and I didn't smoke, and I didn't drink, and I didn't carouse in sin, and said, I've just had a happy life. The next one came up, and they said, he looked as old as the other one. He said, what did you accredit your longevity to? And, I've smoked all my life, and I've drunk liquor all my life, and I've tasted everything you can taste, and I've done this and done that. And they said, how old are you? He said, 27. Brother, I've seen them like that. Did you know that? The most healthy. I've seen little girls come in. Actually, they'd live 40 or 50 years. Their little bodies so young, so young. Little girls that you're looking at tonight had babies at 12. Lost babies another one after. And when you see all that, I mean, if you knew all that those little girls have suffered, little old babies, they ought to have been playing dolls and they were having little babies. Mothers and dads, I think we've forgotten how to be children and how to teach our children to be a child. Oh, the little girls, I know they used to put on the high heel shoes and mother's old dress and all that, but I mean, they were just playing. They had a good time. Now then, the little girls, they stick their ear in the rock and roll, and then they run off and they go down to drink and don't go. And these little girls, some of them have been getting drunk, but they drank their daddy's liquor. Oh, you cannot imagine. And the little systems, how emaciated they are when they come in. The wages of sin is still. I saw the wicked buried. Let's come now to this other verse. I said here today, I wrote S-E-R-M-O-N, the labor of the foolish wearieth every one of them because he knoweth not how to get to the city. I thought about Brother Johnny. Did you know there's a lot of people who don't know how to get to the city?
I mean, you go talking to a drunkard, and he said, well, I sure need to go, and I want to go, but I've got some business affairs to straighten out. He's having a hard time getting to the city. I've seen him get out and catch a bus and then cancel the bus ticket and get drunk and head back into the streets. There have been some of our drunkards died right on the streets of Atlanta, right here. There have been others that found floating in the lakes, and others have been dead on jailhouse floors. One of the young men, you remember, left down there and put a cigarette in his mouth, and he was a cocky sort of a fella, and he said, I'm going to go back and do just what I want to do. It wasn't very long till they reported him dead on the jailhouse floor. Had talent. You heard him play the piano. Had great talent and all that. But he stuck his fist in God's face and lighted his cigarette and drove away like a peacock from the city of refuge and died in his own sin. Ah, listen, just remember, the chickens will come home to roost. The wages of sin is still death. Now then, I got something out of the 10th chapter a while ago. I just read it sitting here, and it said, if the spirit of the ruler rise up against thee, don't run. Oh, that gripped me. He said, leave not thy place. Don't you leave Texas. You say, ah, you know what it meant? Well, that's what it meant to me. I don't know what it meant to you. He said, who's risen up against us? The rulers. Read Psalm chapter 2. You'll find the rulers rising up against God. Find it repeated over in the book of Acts. And he said, they call him the Christ of God and the Lord Jesus, the man of Nazareth. And the rulers, you better hear me, the rulers have always raised up against God. I want to show you something. Did you know there's never been a nation that lost their liberty, ever got it back? Think that over. Number two, did you know there's never been a denomination come back to God after they went away, and all of them have gone away or will go away because God's not in denominations? Now, that shocks some of you old fleece-lined Baptists, doesn't it? Oh, our great heritage, yeah. Brother, you can't live on last year. You can't live on your heritage. We ought to be making another one. Oh, these precious denominational servants. I've heard that till I'm sick. But listen, you better listen just a minute. When the denomination started, the denomination was so humble and so little and so helpless. And this is what they'd say to me 43 years ago. The denominational leader would come to speak, and everybody sort of looked on him as a little god. He'd come in. He was dressed so nice. He'd come in and sit there with great dignity. And he'd get up and he'd say, brethren, it's my desire to be your humble denominational servant. I come as a servant of the churches. Not anymore, boys. They come as the dictator. They come almost with communistic principles today. If they let you have money to build your church, and you decided to swap or step outside the gate, they'll sue you for your property. That's communism. I believe we've got communism in Baptist breeches in this country. You say, won't you give me an illustration? Thank you for asking. Here it comes. They published this widely in Texas. Oh, the welfare rejoiced in that the great Baptist Zion that Dr. Truett used to talk so much about lined up solid with them. In the state of Texas, 191 members of the executive board that I used to sit on, my schoolmates and my preaching buddies and where I went to preach, 191 lined up solid with the welfare and said we believe everything ought to be put under the welfare department. And that nailed these old tired hands to the door of the State Department, but by the grace of God, I'm going to jerk the nails out and ball up my fist again. You got to know what I'm talking about. I know some of y'all got your little denominational nest. Oh, you've called us like Job. Job said, I die in my nest. That's what you think, buddy. God's going to tear your nest wide open. Let me ask you something. What do you ever get done in a nest anyhow? No soldier lives in a nest. But you've got your little nest. And one of these days, like the old mother eagle, God's going to sweep down and knock you off to fly or die. And you ought to die if you don't want to fly. I'm talking about spiritual flying. Brother,
How long is it going to be? How long is it going to be before God's people? You know what a soldier rather do? He'd rather be on the battlefield than any place in the world. If there's a fight to be fought, he'd rather be there than on furlough or home or in a hospital anywhere if he wants to be on the battlefield. Paul was on the battlefield. He was on the battlefield. He was left for dead on the battlefield, and they gathered around him and prayed, and he got up. Can you see that old bloody prophet of God raising up on his elbow and looking, and blood dried on his face, and the disciples said, thank God, he's getting up. The enemy left him and said, he's dead. We never hit a man that many times with the stones we threw without being sure he's dead. Let him die and rot. But he was not rottable. It's a new word. God doesn't rot. The will of God doesn't rot. But it raises. And he got up. Oh, listen, don't you know that's a happy time? Talk about monotonous. Brother, I cannot. I don't even know how to spell monotony. Every day is filled, so filled with so many things. Challenges, cries from Egypt's land. Brother Olaf, take one more. This is mine. You're our last hope. Why, how could it be a dull time? I dread to see dark come because I know I'm going to have to go to bed sometime during the night. I'd rather be up all the rest of my life and somehow comb this harvest field and take in everybody. 3,000 desperate cries from the wilderness saying, come and help me. And we turn them away. Oh, somebody will have to give an account, but we might as well go to conclusion. But notice, he said, the spirit of the ruler rise up against thee. Leave not thy place, for yielding pacifieth great offenses. In other words, if we don't stand, we're a bunch of pacifiers. That's what he says. All right. Now then, if you know anything about our ministry, this right here, verse chapter 11, verse 1, cast thy bread upon the waters, for thou shalt find it after many days. Floating bread. I mean, bread. Now, you know what that is? He says you cast your bread upon the waters. You're going to get it back after many days. At least it won't be dry bread. Lord, it'll have the water of life in it. What'd you say? Casting Bible bread. Casting your bread, that's your talent, your life, your love, everything, into the water of life, the will of God. And floating, just floating wherever he wants you to float. After a while, it'll come back. Chapter 12 for young people. Chapter 11:9. I'm going to give you three more verses. Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth. Let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth. Walk in the ways of thine heart and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou, get this, that for all these things God will bring thee into judgment. You young people think you can shoot dope. You can get mixed up in immorality. But God said, for all these things I'll bring you into judgment. Now then, let's get to the conclusion. A lot of strange things in the book of Ecclesiastes. A lot of things I understand in this book, a lot of things I guess I don't understand. And I know one thing, I'll agree with him on his great conclusion. This is the great conclusion right here. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. That's all of it. I want you to get the conclusion. It's exactly what he says. The wisest man that ever lived outside of Jesus was the man named Solomon. God gave him wisdom like he gave to no other man. He gave him wealth and riches and all the honor and the glitter and the glamour. Wait a minute. Brother Solomon, you sort of led me down some discouraging trails. I've been off in the weeds of despair, but he said, finally, let me give you this. This is the matter. This is the conclusion. Fear God, and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. Now, what have I said tonight? Simply this, and I close. You haven't got one thing to do down here, and that's to stay on the Bible trail. Keep the commandments. You say, but Brother Olaf, do you really believe you've got to keep all 10 commandments in order to go to heaven? I sure do. I sure do. He said, fear God and keep his commandments. Now you're going to ask another question. Have you kept the commandments yourself? No, sir. Are you going to heaven? I really am. That'll be my next stop. How are you going to get there? I met a man called Jesus. And I said, Lord,
I'm a sinner. I've broken so many of the commandments. And he said, well, I have good news for you. I've kept them all. And I swapped my keeping for your breaking. I said, really? He said, I really mean it. I said, you mean to tell me we got to comparing our records? And I had everything on mine nearly. And there it is. I said, how could you ever expect me to go to heaven with a record like that? And Jesus said, let's look at my record. And I looked at his record. And there's everything that's good. Everything that's good. And I thought, my, I never get like that. He said, I'll swap with you. Put yours over here and I'll put mine over there. And I'm going to put yours on my shoulders and haul them up the hill to Calvary. And they're going to be nailed to me. And I'm going to be nailed for you. Brother, that's too good a bargain to pass up. Saved and know it. And saved and kept. That's what this book teaches.